Hi, I'm Senator Kemp Hannon. Welcome to Legislative Report. I want to focus today on legislation we'll be passing this week in regard to return to play of athletes in schools, concussion management. We've been working on this for a number of years as a topic. It's a very complex subject in and of itself. We're affecting the schools around the state, a complex group of different schools, how they're made up, how they're regulated. But what we're trying to do right now is come up with a basic standard so that there's a return to play, who's going to sign off on the return to play, whether a student should be taken out of participation in the athletic contest. And then, of course, along of our explorations, we found out it's not just the athletes, it's any pupil. They could be in physical education, they could be horsing around in the hallways. So we need to bring all of this together and have this done, have the Commissioner of Education, the Commissioner of Health collaborate together, and collaborate in the most important way with the New York State Public Athletic Association, which I found out is the key to so much that happens in athletics in our high schools in the state. When I started out in this legislation about 5 years ago, I thought it would be very easy. It must be state education that does it. No, state education does very little, and in the 5 years, they've diminished the amount of people working in state ed. What it comes down to is a very small, dedicated group of people at the Public Athletic Association, and working with, I would guess, the thousands of coaches and athletic directors and athletic trainers throughout the state who get a small amount of money in their local schools and spend tons of hours above and beyond that in the different types of things going to the regulation. Joining us is Nita Van Ant, who is the executive director, and Brian Rieger, who has participated in some of the concussion work that's been going on, is the Upstate Sports Concussion Institute at Upstate Center, SUNY yeah. Upstate. And I thought, Nina, you've done so much work on this. I first met you 5 years ago, yeah. Crossed paths as my daughters would be on some of the playing fields. I know how hard it is. You have like a 24-hour, 7 days a week job, I guess. So you just finished a weekend of state championships and all very complicated in terms of arrangements and logistics and all of that, and leaving a number of schools happy and a number of schools, well, they didn't win the championship. Yeah. But tell us about a little bit about the Athletic Association and then a little bit about the work that you've led the way on in concussion.
Okay. First, the New York State Public High School Athletic Association is an association of member schools. We have approximately 780 schools from the tip end of the east end of Long Island to Jamestown and outside of the Buffalo area. And with the New York State Public High School Athletic Association, within that membership, we have about 80 non-public members. And what our goal and objective is to do is to provide athletic opportunities for student athletes in an education-based environment. So we not only put on contests and championship events, but we try to teach the other things that are more important, a little bit more important, such as being honest, having integrity, sportsmanship, making good citizens out of our student athletes.
And then, of course, part of it is also coordinating all of the different sectional activities that happen within the state, which is no easy matter. What we have 11 sections, yes. Of our schools are organized in no logical order. I think section 1 is Westchester and section 10 is Nassau. So that, you know, people trying to explain that, I guess it's all historical, not geological. But you coordinate them, and if there are policies to be had, if there are ways of doing contests, regional contests, or if there's eligibility, all of these are determined not as you hand them down, but you organize different committees of different coaches and in different regions to try to come up with those rules.
Yeah, we have a handbook committee that sets all of our standards for eligibility, but then each of our 33 sports have, each of our 11 sections have a representative on that sport committee. And those are the people that really are the heart and soul of our athletic association. They volunteer their services to provide fabulous opportunities for the student athletes and our championship events. Just this weekend, we held baseball, softball, boys and girls lacrosse, track and field, and girls golf. I might have missed one. It was a busy weekend. But hundreds of people volunteer their time and put in a tremendous amount of effort to make everything go so smoothly. This weekend was a little bit of a challenge with all of the rain, but eventually we got everything in.
rain and heat. I think some of the lacrosse tournaments were postponed for a couple hours down in Westchester.
I actually was in White Plains on Wednesday night, and because of the heat index, we did postpone that game until 1 hour, but we got everything in. The heat index was too high. We couldn't allow the student athletes to participate.
And that's the type of determination that people have to make on the spot. There's no way you can hire enough staff to have everybody at every place to make those determinations.
Right, yeah, we spread ourselves pretty thin.
Now, a couple of years ago, we put in some legislation on concussions, and we just called it concussions. It's a technically mild traumatic brain injury. And we said, these are the rules. And then we called around, and you were able to say, it's not that easy.
Yeah, it isn't that easy. But at the time, we had an assistant director, a good friend of yours, eventually a good friend of yours, Lloyd Mott, yes, who was responsible for our safety and research committee. And he put together a group of people, a New York State Public High School Athletic Association's concussion management team. And Brian was a member of that committee. And what they did is they put together the standards on how to deal with concussions, put together an education program, and went around the state putting on workshops to provide the necessary information for coaches, school nurses, athletic trainers, athletic administrators, so that they really understood how severe a concussion could be for student athletes and how serious it was, and not just to consider it, they just got a little ding, or they just got a little dizzy and they can go back in the game.
Well, and people didn't understand that the concussion can be just as much of an injury as breaking your arm, and can maybe have even more serious implications if you come back too quickly.
Yeah, Brian can speak to that.
Well, it's a big problem that a concussion is an invisible injury. There's no medical test that definitively diagnoses a concussion, and that's why what we've seen and again is making sure that everyone understands how to recognize a concussion and how to properly manage it. We all have to be vigilant because it can be difficult to detect sometime. And education, not just for athletic trainers or physicians, but for coaches, for school nurses, for parents.
I think parents may be the most needed, because the kickoff to this last addressing this and getting this legislation was after your work in getting this foundation, your work in lecturing around the state. We had a foundation of people who were aware of it. And it was two or three of the athletic directors who called and said, you know, we think the return to play signatures we're getting, they're just not good enough. We're not doing a good enough job. We're getting the signatures from doctors who are not specialists in the field of brain injury. And ultimately, in the legislation, we still just leave it to doctors. But we put in what, Brian, I think your different consultations have led to, is a lot of the concussion management teams, which are the people already interested, the school nurse, the school doctor, the athletic director, the coaches, who can come together. And they can be a little bit of a hurdle, so have the conversation. It's not air and law, but this is a practical matter. Have a conversation with, doctor, we know you're a urologist, so I'm not so sure you alone should be signing this. Maybe you should consult with a psychologist, a neurologist, somebody like that. But that it's that whole system, and being very conscious of how do you get votes in a legislature, how do you represent and get elected. You know, it's getting a majority and creating that whole thought. And you guys have done this so well.
Well, I'm glad you brought up the point of the concussion teams, because that's really something that grew out of the high school association's work around the state, not just telling people about concussion, but listening to people and finding out what was working in some places, sort of a best practice model. And the concussion checklist came out of that, a form that's being used by many schools now. And we saw that in some districts, you'd get a very invested parent or athletic director, someone who had a personal experience, and they would bring a lot of energy. And we saw that, you know, we could sort of try to harness that by recommending that they form a team to oversee the education and the guidelines. And in places where that's happened, I think it's worked very well. So I appreciate that that's part of the bill.
Well, it's part of it, but it's as a voluntary nature. There is so many concerns right now with how much money we're spending, tax dollars. We have the whole debate going on the property tax cap, but there's so much concern about a mandate. So we have the differences. You have the spread you told us about the high schools, but sometimes it's a very tiny school and sometimes very large.
I think right. And in situations like that, the section concussion management team fills that hole. So in the smaller sections, for instance, up in Section 7 in the Adirondack area, they have a section concussion management team, and that group would be able to assist school districts. And the concussion management committee also went around the state and discovered places where students could be treated, centers where people could get the best care in dealing with concussions. So those places were identified and shared with all of the concussion management teams.
People will say, well, there are limits. You just won't be able, doctor, you just won't be able to see what's happening. Hopefully, some of the scientific research will be able to move us into an era that we will be able to detect it. I know I've been in contact, I'm chair of the health committee, and we had actually worked with the Brain Trauma Institute so that for major trauma, car accidents, something like that, they had a protocol. We helped them get it finalized and then adopted by our big hospitals, university centers, and which twice the chance of recovery, half the cost. They're now started to focus on lots more things. And I just talked to them the other day. They're going to be working with all the interested parties throughout the nation as to just defining what a mild traumatic brain injury is. Because I thought that at least that was accepted, but...
Not yet.
Not yet.
But there's been more research on concussion in the last 5 years than all previous years combined. The interest in sports and the military. As a person who's been working in this area for over 10 years now, it's really exciting. We have a long way to go, but I think we're seeing some new developments.
Nina, let me just switch a little bit. You've been in the forefront. When I started, I thought everybody would know what a concussion is. A coach would know how to deal with this. Quickly disabused of that. Yeah. And yet, with positive steps. Instead of pointing fingers or just going to the press and saying we're not doing anything about it, we all work together to help something. How do we move forward with safety in sports? The primary thing comes about with the high school sports because that's what everybody's closest to, the most participants in the nation. But what's a process for arriving at evidence-based decisions on this?
Well, we have our safety committee, and our assistant director, Todd Nelson, who was on your show a while ago, he's responsible along with each of the sections have a representative on that safety committee. And what we do is we gather data. For instance, we've done data collection on injuries in softball and baseball to see if any changes needed to be made with that. Most recently, the National Federation moved the pitching distance back 43 feet, which allows a little bit better time for reaction when the ball is hit, but it also puts the ball in play more. We are now collecting data on injuries in girls' lacrosse. We did the same thing for field hockey and lacrosse years ago, and that resulted in putting goggles on field hockey players and goggles on lacrosse players prior to the National Federation's mandate of eye protection. So I think we're on the cutting edge of safety, minimizing risk for our
students. So we're going to have to call on you for doing some more and maybe make this a little more of a formal process or assisting you in the formal way.
Well, that would be great.
I thank you very much. We've run out of time. We obviously could talk about this for quite a long way. Thank you very much for your good work. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I'm Senator Kemp Hannon. Thanks for being with us. I'll see you again next time.